So friends, today we are discussing some questions in 2020 examination of UPSC mains political science. So yes, last session we had discussed two questions. Those were related to international relations and theory of political science, right? One was on idealism and other was on balance of power. Today we are going to take one theoretical question from paper 1, section 1, and I have chosen deliberately a slightly complicated question that most of the student will find that difficult to handle, because most of the questions in paper 1 were direct. Machiavelli's concept of secularism was asked, you know, so questions were pretty much direct. Only one question I found was not as direct as it might have been. So we will discuss that question first. So the question is, make comparative assessment of Greek perspective of justice with the Rawlsian concept of justice. Now we are asked to do comparative assessment. Comparative assessment, mostly misunderstood by aspirants or candidates as highlighting the difference between the two. In comparative assessment, we have to highlight not just difference, but we also have to state similarities, because it is about comparison, not just about highlighting difference. Okay. Since it is about Greek perspective of justice and Rawlsian concept of justice, the Greek perspective of justice we have in syllabus Plato and Aristotle. Both of these are Greek thinkers, and they have given extensive ideas about justice, right? But for the sake of simplicity, we will restrict our discussion to Plato and Rawls, because if I involve Aristotle over here, it will become complicated, right? So for the sake of simplicity only, because I want to highlight the approach, the right approach to right answer. Okay, so for the sake of simplicity, I am going to take just Plato and Rawls, and I will exclude deliberately Aristotle out. Okay, so first try to understand the modern concept of justice and ancient concept of justice. You know, modern concept of justice is more about rights, and ancient concept of justice was more about duty. If you can take an example, even in India, we had Varna Vyavastha. So Varna Vyavastha was based on functional specialization and division of responsibilities. Okay, it was not a matter of right. If I want to be a lawyer, I didn't have the right to be a lawyer, right? Because I had to do a job which is suitable to my capacity or my capability. So that's why in ancient times, the concept of justice was more tilted towards duty, because everybody has a specific function to perform. Everybody has a specific duty to perform. And Plato's concept of justice was also similar to that. Plato divided human personality into three parts. One, he said that certain people are where appetite is dominant. And those people where appetite is dominant are not suitable to rule. Only the people who have good wisdom, have right knowledge, or what he called knowledge of form, are suitable for rule, right? So every individual, based upon his unique temperament, will do his job in society. And this is his duty. It's not a matter of right, because if I am fit for being a lawyer, then it is my duty to be a lawyer. I can use a quote from a famous quote from Aristotle. He says, if a person is fit to be a teacher and he becomes a soldier, then there is a double loss to society. Number one, that we lose a good teacher, and number two, we get a bad soldier, right? So their concept of justice was more tilted towards duty of an individual towards the society. And you know, there was a logic. Things normally things are not without logic. So Plato also provided some logic. Plato said that no individual is self-sufficient. Every individual is dependent on others for certain of his need to be met, right? So that's why Plato argued that certain people who are suitable to do certain things will have to perform those tasks. For example, somebody is a good carpenter, he must do carpentry. If some person is suitable for being a doctor, he must be a doctor, right? So in short, that no individual can meet all his needs on his own. That's why we need different people to perform different functions. And no individual can perform all the functions. That's why we need a functional specialization and division of labor. If we do this way, there is also one more benefit, that we will eliminate the scarcity. For example, a good carpenter will, or good shoemaker will make 100 shoes a day, right? But a bad shoemaker will make 10 shoes a day. So if we put appropriate person to person or his skills to use, then we will get more number of shoes, we will get more number of chairs. So the problem of scarcity is addressed. And once the problem of scarcity is addressed, then there is no dispute about the distribution of goods and services, right? And modern concept of justice is different in this regard, because modern concept of justice is not to address the problem of scarcity, right? The modern of concept of justice admits that there is scarcity and there is inequality. And because there is inequality, we need to do distribution of resources, right? And state has very important role in it. So the role of state is very important in bringing about equality in the modern concept of justice. Whereas in the Plato scheme of thing, he did not use the state as an instrument to bring about equality, as an instrument to do distributive justice. In fact, he equalized the wealth. He says that ruling class will not have right to wealth, right? Because if they have the wealth, then there will be personal interest and conflict of interest, and the ruling class will not rule in the interest of the people. Rather the ruling class will rule in the interest of itself. So that's why Plato thought that ruling class must not have property, because property has disturbing influence on the ruling class. It brings conflict of interest, and self-interest will dominate, and as a result the ruling class will not rule or govern in the interest of general public or public interest. Rather, they will govern or rule in the interest of personal interest. Okay, so when we talk about equality, justice has certain dimensions like liberty. No theory of justice is complete without talking about liberty, without talking about equality. So we will deal with the core dimension of justice: equality and freedom. So in Plato, slave and woman were treated differently. Slaves were not entitled to be citizen. There were two class of people: one was citizen and one was state. Slave, and slaves had very little rights, right? So slaves and women were treated differently. Division in society between citizen and non-citizen, right? So citizens enjoyed different rights, whereas non-citizens had different duties to perform. Rawls focused on fair equality of opportunity to all. So this is the key difference. You know, Plato also talked about equality in different sense. He says that democracy, equals and unequals both are treated equal. When we talk about equals and unequals, there are certain people who are historically different, discriminated, who lack some capabilities, right? If, for example, I may lack capability to be a judge, then I cannot be equated with a person who has the capability to be a judge, because if I be a judge, I will be a bad judge, right? So Plato says that unequals must not be treated equally. A judge cannot be treated equally with a lawyer, right? We have to distinguish, right? Here, the Rawls is giving the concept of fairness. He says, that equality of opportunity has to be fair. For example, if somebody has some disadvantage or somebody has lacks some things because of chance, right? That is not his own making, but because of brute luck, he says. If somebody lacks something, that he must be provided some assistance by the state so that he can be equal to the others who do not lack those things, who are better off section of the society, right? So fairness has to be there. That means some assistance has to be provided by the state so that those who are unequal can be brought, the initial disadvantage of the people who are initially disadvantaged can be brought equal to those who are initially advantageous, and then the equality of opportunity can be fair. For example, second principle of John Rawls, where he says positions and offices have to be open to all, following the principle of fair equality of opportunity. Plato was completely against it. You know, Plato says that offices and positions cannot be open to all. You know, offices has to be reserved for certain people who have certain qualities. And for example, rulers have to be person who have good wisdom, right? So if you lack the wisdom, you cannot be a ruler, right? You cannot be a soldier if you are not courageous, according to Plato. So you have to be courageous to be a soldier. Whereas in Plato's scheme of thing, everybody is entitled to aspire for any position or any office, and that opportunity has to be fair. That means if somebody is, for example, in India, concept of reservation is there based upon caste, and caste is based upon historical discrimination and historical disadvantages met to certain sections of Indian society, right? So these people are initially at disadvantage vis-a-vis certain other people. So in order to bring them up, in order to equalize their initial position, the government of India provides certain support in the form of education, in the form of reservation, right? So this is the concept of fairness. But that concept of fairness is lacking in Aristotle, and not just that, but Aristotle also does not make open offices and position to all the people. Only certain type of people who have certain appetite, certain aptitude can only fit to be ruled and can only fit to be soldier. Now, we can talk about freedom. John Rawls gives maximum possible freedom to all. That's a very important point. Here, freedom, in the case of freedom, Plato is saying that freedom can corrupt. Reason is that if you give so much freedom, for example, he gave the example of democracy. In democracy, everybody is free. So since everybody is free, nobody is doing his duty, because focus of Plato is on duty. Everybody should perform the task he is fit to do, right? So nobody is performing his duty, and because of the freedom, there is chaos and instability in the society, and that results in different things that are not good for the benefit, or that are not in benefit of the society. Okay, now maximum possible freedom to all. In John Rawls' scheme of things, all must have equal right to it. Here again, equality principle is stressed by John Rawls. All must have most equal right to most extensive liberty, most extensive liberty, but compatible with similar liberty of others. Compatible with similar liberty of other. What is the meaning of that? When I have the right to absolute freedom, right? I can hurt somebody. I can also have right to kill somebody, but I cannot have the right to kill. Compatible with similar liberties of others. That means other also have similar liberties. So I must have that much freedom that will not hurt the freedom of others, right? So in order to have that kind of thing, he provided the concept of compatible liberty. इफ आई कैन किल समवन देन हिज लिबर्टी इज ऑल्सो हर्ट देन दैट मीन्स ही डू नॉट हैव द राइट टू मोस्ट एक्सटेंसिव लिबर्टी दैट वायलेट्स द फर्स्ट प्रिंसिपल सो दैट्स वाई इंडिविजुअल हैज अ ड्यूटी नॉट टू हर्ट अदर्स फ्रीडम राइट सो ही ऑल्सो ब्रिंग्स इन द कॉन्सेप्ट or the concept of duty into his theory, but in a different way. I do not have a duty to perform certain tasks which I am designed to do by nature. But I have a duty to protect, to act or behave in a certain way that it will not hurt the freedom of others. Right? So concept of duty is provided in theory of John Rawls as well, but it is slightly in different manner. Okay. Okay, so we have already discussed the concept of duty. We have discussed rights, preference to given by Plato is to the duty, whereas preference to right in John Rawls' theory. Affirmative action provide for welfare state. John Rawls, as we have discussed, has scope for welfare state. He says that public goods or personal liberties or political rights have to be distributed fairly in the society. Whereas Plato equalizes wealth. This is an excellent argument by Sabine. We have to also use scholarly opinion. So this is an excellent argument by Sabine that not use state to equalize wealth, but equalize wealth in order to remove its disturbing influence on state. But, right, in a welfare state have to step in to remove inequalities in society. State has to, for example, provide welfare programs like right to MNREGA scheme, right? Right to employment. Okay. Then state have to provide different schemes for upliftment of scheduled caste and scheduled tribes, right? So state have certain responsibility to equalize or to remove the inequality present in society. Whereas he do not give such role to state. He says that state, that individual should not have property if individual is a ruler. That means he first equalize wealth. Okay, because he says that wealth has a corrupting influence on the ruler. Because wealth, if you have wealth, you become greedy. If you become greedy, you will not rule in the interest of people. That's why his precondition for an ideal state is that rulers must not have wealth. So right to property is denied to ruling class by Plato. And this is a very good argument by Sabine that you can use and you may note it down separately. Okay. So right to property, ruling class has no right to property. Right to property is important because it is linked to individual freedom. In Rawlsian scheme of things, right to property. Democracy, Plato was against democracy because he says that democracy provide absolute freedom, and absolute freedom means nobody will perform his duty. And because nobody will perform his duty, so there is a problem of stability in the state and society. Okay. Whereas Rawls was all for liberal democracy. Okay, second question. How do the guiding principles of India-Africa relations seek to enhance harmony and mutual cooperation between India and Africa? This is very important. You know, question is simple and direct. There is not much complication involved. And you have to write straightforward points and argument in it. But the thing is that when the question is specifically focusing on harmony and mutual cooperation in the context of guiding principle of India-Africa relations. So there are some guiding principles that Prime Minister Narendra Modi in his speech to Ugandan Parliament highlighted. You know, why there was a need for some guiding principles? We have had good cordial relationship with African countries from long time, from the common destiny of fighting colonialism to... All right, so we were discussing guiding principles, why there was a need for guiding principles. You know, India had set a very ambitious target of mutual trade with Africa and investment of $150 billion and $100 billion respectively. But what happened that we could not meet the target. Instead of looking to meet the target, we have been declining in our target. For example, in 2014 and 2013, we had a bilateral trade of around $70 billion. Whereas in 2017-18, it declined to somewhere around $59 billion. Okay. So because of certain things not going right, and there were certain reasons for that, we will discuss later on. The Prime Minister and the government of India, in a way to assure the African countries, gave these certain guiding principles that we are there, and it is not that we have given something new. You know, it is mostly the continuation of existing policies, right? But the change in priorities, we have only highlighted the change in priorities, whereas it is not something new. It has already been in continuation as a government of India's policy towards the African countries and bilateral relations with African countries. Okay. Now, spirit of developing together as equals defines the bilateral partnership. It is very important. Developing together as equals. You know, African countries have a fear of persecution and discrimination against them since the colonial times. And since most of the countries are still least developing countries, they feel that their resources may be exploited by the world powers for their own benefit and they will not get much in return. Right? So we have focused on developing together as equals to just give an assurance to the Africans that we are here for a mutually beneficial, you know, mutual cooperation for a mutually beneficial outcome and not just to serve our own personal national interest, right? And there is a concept of enlightened national interest. It is basically derived from Aristotle's concept of enlightened personal interest, right? So enlightened personal interest is that I should serve my personal interest in a manner that it also benefits the others. That means we should have a symbiotic relationship in a society, not a parasitic relationship, right? I might benefit from society, but I might benefit in such a way that it also benefit society in return. So on the basis of that concept, Indian government has been using the concept of enlightened national interest, right? So we want to achieve good of our people, but not at the cost of other, right? So there is no zero-sum game. We are for harmonious cooperation. So significance of the term harmonious is that we believe in enlightened national interests and there is no parasitic relationship. We want to benefit ourselves. At the same time, we also benefit the other side. Okay. Okay, framework of South-South cooperation. Like these are the guiding principles, right? So they were quite elaborate. So I just concise them, and I have just focused on the areas. Indian market for African products. We have assured them that African products will get adequate access to Indian market, so that their exports to Indian market are not discriminated against. Okay. Second thing is improve Africa's agricultural potential. This is very important. The world's 60% arable land lies in Africa, whereas the total produce share of Africa in the world is 10%. That means there is a huge scope for improvement. If we can exploit that potential, we can actually solve the problem of malnutrition and hunger in the world, right? That's why India has focused specifically on agriculture potential of Africa. Fight against climate change together. You know, we have been met with some historical injustice in the area of climate change. Developed countries have taken advantage of early starter or early developing countries, and that's why they have created huge carbon emissions. And now they ask us to restrict our carbon emissions, right? So we have to find those neo-colonial tendencies present in the world still. And there is a commonality and harmony of interest between African countries and India. So that's why we also want to exploit this potential. Work together to keep oceans and maritime lanes free for all. So there is a huge significance for this, not just for India, but African countries as well. You know, every trade has to pass through sea lines of communication. And if there is danger to those routes, there is safety and security concern to the cargoes, then the cost of transportation will go up. So the competitiveness of industries and the competitiveness of producers will come down. The reason is, if the safety and security concerns are there, then insurance costs will go up, because insurance company will demand high premium, right? So the cost of transportation will go up for different other reasons as well. Obviously, there is something called high risk area, you know, because of piracy, high risk area. It was shifting eastward. The high risk area was shifting eastwards towards western coast of India. Because this high risk area was shifting towards western coast of India, because of the eastern movement of piracy in Indian Ocean, the cost of insurance premium demanded by insurance company went up, and that's why the competitiveness of the producers and Indian industries was impacted. Okay, so to keep oceans free from maritime lanes, oceans and maritime lanes free for all is also very important. Safety and security of maritime lanes is also very important. That's why Indian Navy undergoes anti-piracy operations from Gulf of Aden to Mozambique Channel. You know, Gulf of Aden to Mozambique Channel lies on the eastern side of Africa. So the eastern side of Africa lies this channel. So India is somewhere there, right? So Indian Navy has been conducting anti-piracy operation into this region from Gulf of Aden to Mozambique Channel. These geographical terms are very important to mention, because it only projects the clarity. You need not have to provide diagram, but if either you provide a diagram or you just mention the geographical terms, Gulf of Aden to, because you also have to substantiate with example. You have to say, tell the examiner that you are not making comments in air, right? So you substantiate with example. It is good for your value addition, and it is always going to get you more marks than others. This exam is not writing about perfect answer. This exam is about writing better than others. Right, so many people will miss some examples, many people will miss using some geographical location in international relation, but you should not miss. You should make use of those geographical locations in order to highlight to the examiner that you understand the concept, right? And you understand the relevance and practicality of the concept as well. Okay, then we have to work together for a just, representative, democratic global order. Here we can talk about UNSC reforms. UNSC reforms. UNSC reforms, India wants to have a permanent membership, and African countries also wants 2 seats with veto power and 5 seats without veto power as a permanent member, which they can rotate within themselves. Okay, so there is also a commonality of interest or harmony of interest existing between the India and African countries. Now we can talk about context, right? We have given the guiding principles. We can also provide context under which these guiding principles came, right? One context was that trade was declining. In spite of the ambitious target, the trade was declining, hai na? And then we can talk about some theoretical terminologies in IR as well, like compared to other big powers who are trying to get into gold rush for exploitation of Africa's natural resources by way of neo-colonial approaches. So neo-colonial approaches, this is very important, because we have to keep in mind that we are writing in political science optional. So some scientific terminologies and jargons related to political science optional IR should be there. For example, I have talked about enlightened national interest. So when you talk about enlightened national interest, it is already a scientific term, right? So you will always score better in this part compared to others. You know, other big powers, as I have discussed, want to exploit resources from Africa. Whereas India says, we are not following these neo-colonialist approaches, right? We are for Africa, for the Africans first. So India's approach is Africa for the African first, rather than mere resource target for the world. So we want to help you. We are there to support you in the endeavor for your development. Okay. That's why we have focused on enlightened national interest. Continent is likely to present, you know. So one thing is that we want to help you on contrast with the approach of major big powers, right? And second thing is the potential of Africa. You know, why India want to be there? Because the potential is huge, that $5.6 trillion of market by 2025. It is the potential to become so big market. The consumer, 1.5 billion consumers in African market. So it's a huge market, right? And India wants to provide our industries access to this market, right? Because we want jobs. We want to increase exports. But we want to do it not at the cost of African interest. We want to make sure that Africa for Africans first, right? Africa has 60% of world's arable land, as I have already mentioned, but produce just 10% of the global output. So there is a huge scope for agricultural cooperation. Now, once we have provided the context, we have to make sure that in the body, we cover all aspects that we have mentioned in the context and the general introduction of the question. Okay. So this is a normal graph that I have talked about, that since 2008, how the bilateral trade between India and Africa has been. So it first increased and it reached the maximum in 2014. So in 2014, the trade reached maximum of $78 billion. And thereafter, it started declining in 2016 and 2018-19. So I have taken the data till 2018-19 because the guiding principles came in 2018, right? So the data was taken till 2017 and 18, just to show that because the trade declined, so there was a compelling reason for a change. And in that context, India gave these guiding principles. Okay. Now, India's approach. So, as I've already discussed, वी वॉन्ट टू प्रायोरिटाइज नीड्स ऑफ एफ्रीकन स्टेक होल्डर्स, राइट? दिस इज इम्पॉर्टेंट बिकॉज वी आर नॉट हेयर फॉर न्यू कॉलोनियलिस्ट एक्सपेंशन. फर्स्ट थिंग इज एनर्जी सिक्योरिटी. एज ऑलवेज एनर्जी सिक्योरिटी इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट बिकॉज फॉर एग्जाम्पल नाइजीरिया इज वन ऑफ द मेजर सप्लायर ऑफ ऑयल एंड नेचुरल रिसोर्सेज टू इंडिया. सो एनर्जी सिक्योरिटी इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. नाउ सेकेंड थिंग, वी कैन डू कोलैबोरेशन विद लाइक माइंडेड कंट्रीज, म्यूचुअली बेनिफिशियल ट्राइलेटरल एग्रीमेंट्स. फॉर एग्जाम्पल एशिया अफ्रीका ग्रोथ कॉरिडोर. सो हियर सर्टेन एडवांटेजेस इंडिया हैव एंड सर्टेन एडवांटेजेस जापान हैव एंड बोथ कैन कॉम्प्लीमेंट ईच अदर. फॉर एग्जाम्पल इंडिया हैज ह्यूज एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ एफ्रीकन मार्केट्स वेर एज जापान लैक इट. ओके, बट जापान हैज फंड्स टू प्रोवाइड इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चरल डेवलपमेंट विच कैन इन्हेंस द कनेक्टिविटी इन एफ्रीकन कंट्रीज एंड ऑल्सो इन रिड्यूस द कॉस्ट ऑफ ट्रांसपोर्टेशन फॉर देम फॉर द गुड्स एंड सर्विसेज, राइट? सो वी हैव टू क्रिएट अ विन विन सिनेरियो. विन विन सिनेरियो मीन्स वी वॉन्ट टू बेनिफिट बट नॉट एट द कॉस्ट ऑफ यू. यू शुड ऑल्सो बेनिफिट एनलाइटेंड नेशनल इंटरेस्ट. सो वी हैव टू क्रिएट विन विन सिनेरियो एंड विन विन सिनेरियो इज कंबाइनिंग इंडियाज एक्सपीरियंस and understanding of the African market with Japan's technological know-how. If we can combine these two, the partnership will enhance the Africans' interest and this will be a win-win scenario. So we also have to highlight keywords. As I have highlighted keywords like Africa for Africans first, neo-colonialist approaches, because we got to make task for examiner easier. So we also have to keep in mind that keywords have to be underlined. Okay. Now, as there was one more point on global order, just and democratic global order. For that UNSC reforms were important, and India, Japan under G4 are also partner. Are also aspiring for permanent seat at UNSC. Okay, so here India and Japan can together work in Africa and can get a support for their mutual permanent membership from African countries, because their support is very important, because there are large number of countries, around 60 countries are there in African continent. So getting their support in United Nations for permanent membership of both India and Japan is crucial. So there is again mutuality of interest and harmony of interest, right? So we are solely focusing on the demand of the question, mutual cooperation and harmonious cooperation, right? Okay, in the digital field, we have also mentioned digital issues in guiding principles. So we can make use of Pan-Africa e-network for education and telemedicine. India has huge experience because we have launched Digital India, BharatNet, Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana in India, and we have experience. We can help African countries for their benefit, right? Similarly, trade. Okay, India provide duty-free access. Okay, under duty-free trade preferences scheme to African countries. In that, this is just a factual information. There is no analysis involved because we have to also provide factual information to support our argument. Okay, so we can make that 96% of the tariff lines are subject to preferential duties. We are providing duty-free access. This is the key word. We are providing duty-free access to how much? 96% of the tariff lines. to African countries. So 96% of the goods exported to India are getting duty-free access. Okay, so this is also important. Though there is also a scope for improvement, for example, some important component of their export, for example, fruits and vegetables, cashew nuts, coffee, tea, wine and spirits, spices. These are goods that are very important for their that are very important component of their export basket. These goods are not getting duty free access because we have domestic concerns also. We have to protect our domestic farmers in interest. So that's why we are not giving duty free access to these fruits. We may argue that we can make some relaxations here also for giving a good assurance to the African countries. Okay. Now India can also help in agriculture sector because we have soil health card scheme. So soil testing is a very important component of the soil health card, so that we can get, we can provide inputs based on the conditions and the needs of the soil. If there is an overuse of urea, then by testing the sample of soil, we can provide that, okay, we don't have to provide so much urea to the soil. We have to provide only this much urea, this much potassium, and so on and so forth. So the nutrition profile of the soil can be gauged, and based on the nutrition profile of the soil, one can provide the right combination or right proportion of the nutrition needed by the soil. Okay, so that can be made use for the benefit of African countries, because experience of India can be utilized by these countries for their own agriculture benefit. Second important for India is pulses export, because India normally faces shortage of pulses exports, and we have seen that pulses in our country. We have seen the high inflation in previous years in pulses of our country, right? So for example, Mozambique and Tanzania, we have had agreement with these countries, right? And there are also some problems with these with these countries, because we have signed an assured agreement that we will buy so and so much quantity of pulses at so and so prices. We have assured them, but we did not fulfill our commitment properly because of certain domestic reasons. Okay, so there is also a concern here, right? So we can make use of it in our answer. The idea is that we not just highlight the positive side. It is good to highlight positive side. It is essential to highlight positive side. But we are also highlighting simultaneously certain issues involved, right? Now, open and free oceans, I have already discussed. Indian Ocean, Indian Navy's maritime strategy document, and African Union's Africa Integrated Maritime Strategy. There is need to harmonize these two. There is, because the question is on harmony. So we can argue that there is a need to harmonize these two. We have also Sagar Initiative and Sagar Mala Initiative. So we can harmonize for the mutual benefit. Environment and climate change. Again, environment and climate change I have already discussed, right? Piracy, these are some challenges. Now we are also talking about some challenges. In challenges, this is important point, cost of strategic minerals. You know, strategic minerals, for example, minerals used for the manufacturing of batteries, right? So these minerals are very important resource for India's self-reliance on clean energy targets. If India had to meet clean energy, and if India have to be self-reliant on the technology of clean energy, then strategic minerals or access to these strategic minerals like cobalt is very essential for India. And for example, Congo is one of the largest producer of this material, and that country in some few years ago have raised the cost of this material quite significantly. You know, so India can go for joint collaboration, joint exploitation of those certain strategic mines in Africa to secure our access to strategic minerals, which is very essential for our clean energy targets and self-reliance of India in the green energy. Terrorism and growing radicalization. We have seen that there are so many terrorist organizations in operating in African countries have links with Afghan Pakistan organizations or terror groups working in Afghanistan and Pakistan. So they share quite a symbiotic relationship. That's why we also have to focus on these areas. Limited access to trade and finance. Now one very important challenge, as I have discussed, the cost of insurance. Now limited access to trade and finance is also a very important challenge. Why I'm saying it? You know, there are certain stringent regulatory rules in African countries, because of which so many banks are backing out. And because the banks are backing out, that's why they don't get the required finance for promotion of international trade, right? Because of the lack of finance, the trade is suffering. Now, we can also talk about trade issues specifically. Quantitative restrictions that we have imposed, as I have mentioned, some challenges regarding India buying pulses from there. So we have Indian government imposed quantitative restrictions on certain pulses. So this can also be incorporated under the challenge segment. Okay. Yeah, I have missed one point in it related to agriculture. India is looking to take cooperative contractual farming model to African countries. This is important because we want to do it in India itself, and we want to make our experience put to good use in African countries as well. And this will be a mutually beneficial thing if we can do it, because as I have already mentioned, the significance of Africa in when it comes to world's food security and malnutrition. Okay, so we can link it with that. Okay, the next question I would like to discuss is the efficacy of India's no first use policy, nuclear weapons, in the context of evolving strategic challenges in its neighbors. You know, this year so many questions were asked from regarding the neighbors. At least four questions were asked which were specifically dealing with SAARC nations, Bangladesh, trade related issues in SAARC, right? At least four questions were there. And one question is focusing on nuclear policy of India in the context of neighbors, strategic challenges emanating from neighbors. This is again 15 marks question, right? So the stress of this year's international paper was quite balanced. There was significant number of questions for internationally related developments. But they have also asked good number of questions which are related to India's neighborhood. Okay, this is one of those questions. Now this, India's no first use policy states that nuclear weapon can only be used as retaliation against a nuclear attack on Indian territory or Indian forces anywhere. This is the key word, anywhere. That means if Indian forces are attacked by a nuclear weapon anywhere in the world, not necessarily on Indian soil, we will retaliate against any nuclear attack of that sort, right? So this is one important point. Let's focus on core issues with our nuclear policy, then we will discuss this concept, this question in detail. You know, one of the core doctrine or core nuclear posture that we have adopted was no first use, as asked in the question. Second was मिनिमम क्रेडिबल डिटरेंस, मिनिमम क्रेडिबल डिटरेंस, एम सी डी, रिमेंबर द एक्रोनिम, मिनिमम क्रेडिबल डिटरेंस. दिस टर्म क्रेडिबल इज ऑफ ग्रेट सिग्निफिकेंस फॉर एनी न्यूक्लियर पॉलिसी, बिकॉज एनी न्यूक्लियर पॉलिसी और यूज ऑफ न्यूक्लियर वेपन इज यूज फॉर अ स्पेसिफिक पर्पज. इट इज नॉट फॉर यूजिंग इन एक्चुअल वॉर. इंडिया इज नॉट डेवलपिंग न्यूक्लियर वेपन्स टू बी यूज इन एक्चुअल वॉर कंडीशन. वी हैव डेवलप्ड इट एज ए मीन्स ऑफ डेटरेंस. दिस इज वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट दैट वी हैव यूज्ड इट एज ए मीन्स ऑफ डेटरेंस एंड नॉट टू बी यूज इन एक्चुअल वॉर लाइक सिचुएशन. Okay, so credibility comes into play when we are talking about deterrence. You know, if I have nuclear weapon in and I will not use it, my adversary knows that I will not use nuclear weapon come what may, then there is no credibility and there is no deterrence. So credibility is essential component of deterrence. If and only if a threat it is credible, adversary will be deterred against using force. If the threat is not credible, adversary will have no interest in deterring or use of force, right? So credibility of threat is very important. That's why India specifically mentioned minimum credible deterrence. So deterrence we are focusing, we are not intending to use it in actual war. Okay. Now there is also something called assured retaliation. Assured retaliation. Assured retaliation comes in to ensure the adversary that we will retaliate if attacked anywhere in the world, right? We will retaliate if nuclear weapons are used against us. That is provided because of this, to enhance the credibility of our nuclear deterrence, right? So we have provided that we will retaliate and that retaliation will be massive. So we are not going for a proportionate retaliation, which is generally a norm, right? The norm is that if adversary is throwing one bomb at you, you should also retaliate proportionately. You should also throw one bomb. If they are killing 10 people of your army, you should also kill 10 people of their army. More than that, that means disproportionate retaliation is not acceptable, right? But we have made clear, even if a tactical weapon is used against us, tactical weapon are very low yield weapon. They are actually can be deployed for actual war, that as Pakistan is using it as a counter to India's cold start doctrine, right? So if even the tactical weapon is used against us, there will be a retaliation, and that retaliation will be massive. Okay, so another keyword is that it is not necessarily that we will also retaliate proportionately, we will retaliate massively. So beware of using such weapons against us. Why we are saying it? Again, to enhance credibility of our threat of using nuclear weapon. Why we are focusing on credibility? Credibility is very essential for creating deterrence. Okay. Now, what is the significance of no first use in this? Significance of no first use. No first use significance are twofold. Number one, to project credibility. Why? When we are saying that we will not be the first to use, that means our adversary knows that we are confident. We are not worried that if you attack us first, we are confident that we will still have enough strength left that we can launch a counter strike. That means we have second strike capability. So no first use is given to assure or to project confidence about our no strike, our second strike capability. So it is also enhancing what? Our credibility. That's number one. Second thing, fear of using nuclear weapon accident.